Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you and we praise you for your word, which is the truth. This night we receive your word written in our heart, written in our mind. We thank you for bringing revelation of all the things that Jesus has accomplished. We praise you for what you're going to bring forth this night. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated if you would. Tonight we're going to talk to you about the subject of the fall feasts of the Lord. We must understand that the feasts of the Lord are not Jewish feasts. The feasts of the Lord, which are discussed in Leviticus chapter 23, are God's feasts. Notice what he says, Leviticus 23, verse 2. Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them concerning the feasts of the Lord, which you'll proclaim in there to be holy convocations, even these are my feasts. What are these feasts? These feasts were times when they would, appointed times when they would come together before God. It wasn't a time of having a big meal. It didn't have anything to do with that. It was appointed times coming before God that they were meeting with God at these particular times. Why was this important? Because it was all pointing towards the work of Jesus Christ that was going to be accomplished. There are seven feasts. The first four feasts have already been fulfilled by Jesus Christ. The feast of Passover has been fulfilled because Jesus was the Passover lamb who became sin on the very day of Passover. The Feast of Unleavened Bread, which was the putting away of the sin, has been fulfilled because Jesus is the one, having been made sin, went down into hell for 3 days and three nights, bearing away the sin of the world, having paid the price. The Feast of First Fruits has been fulfilled because after Jesus was raised from the dead, he went up to heaven and poured out his blood on the mercy seat and waved that sheaf of the first fruits before God, the fact that redemption had been accomplished and he had brought forth the new creation, as the Old Testament saints who had had the gospel preached to them down in the upper compartment of hell in Abraham's bosom, they had received the gospel and they had come up out and they had been born again. Jesus, of course, was the first born from the dead. Then 50 days later, on the very day of Pentecost, which was again talking about the work of Jesus, after Jesus went back to heaven, he received from the Father the Holy Spirit, and he poured out the Holy Spirit on that day, sent it into the earth on the very day of Pentecost. And what happened? That was the beginning of the church age, the birthday of the church. People could be born again and receive the Holy Spirit. And so now that men and women who were alive could be born again, now they had a relationship with God. And now we have seen the church age, and that has been going on for nearly 2,000 years. Those have all been fulfilled. But there's three more feasts. And those three feasts which are to be fulfilled are the Feast of Trumpets, the Day of Atonement, and the Feast of Tabernacles. The first four feasts speak of the first coming of Jesus and what he accomplished. The last three feasts speak of the second coming of Jesus and what he will accomplish at his second coming. Also, the feasts typify for us as believers the work of God that he is doing in our life in all these areas to bring us the place of walking in his ways, being righteous and holy before him, and to be a part of the glorious end-time church that there's going to be before Jesus comes back. We're going to talk about trumpets and atonement and tabernacles tonight, not in depth, but we're going to cover the major points. We see in Leviticus chapter 23, we pick up over in verse 24. He says, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, shall you have a Sabbath, a memorial, a blowing of trumpets. This is the Feast of Trumpets and holy convocation. I want you to notice it's the seventh month and the first day of the month. Now, this is speaking of God's months, which are Hebrew months, months that were God's months from according to his calendar. And these are based on the lunar movement, because God's calendar is a lunar calendar. That's why the change of the different things that occur from year to year, they're not the same time. The enemy, through the sun worshipers, changed our calendar to a solar calendar. It's not God's calendar. God's calendar is a lunar calendar. The seventh month is the time, which is the month Tishri. This is the time of the fall of the year, which would be September and or October, depending upon the movement of the moon. And this is the only one of the feasts that occurs on the first day of the month. This is why the Feast of Trumpets, you don't know exactly what day it's going to fall upon. You don't know the very day, you don't know the very hour, because it's always comes when there's the first sliver of the new moon. Well, you don't know if it's going to happen maybe 10 o'clock at night, or maybe it'll happen at 2 o'clock in the morning, or which day it's going to be. That's what it says and means when it says you won't know the day and the hour of his coming, because that is speaking of the Feast of Trumpets, which is the catching up of the church to meet the Lord in the air. That's the first day. It says they'll do no servile work therein, but they'll shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. The Lord spake to Moses, and he said there, and on the tenth day, this we come to the second one, and we'll get to this in a minute. But the first one was a blowing of trumpets. This was something that was where God was going to come and meet with them to bring forth what he purposed in their life. Because it not only signifies the fact that the second coming of Jesus Christ, but we also see in Exodus chapter 19, over in verse 16, it says, it came to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud upon the mountain and the voice of the trumpet. When the trumpet comes forth, we want to pay attention to these things, because this is speaking about something that God is bringing forth, trumpets. Exceeding loud, so that all the people was in the camp, they trembled. And Moses brought forth the people out of the camp to meet God. They stood at the nether part of the mount. When trumpets are sounded, it is bringing forth a meeting with God, signaling the fact that the people were going to meet with God. That's what God wants for you and me. We must understand in a personal application, after you've been born again and you've received the Holy Spirit and you put the Word first place and you begin to walk in His ways, He wants to meet with you, because He wants to reveal Himself to you. He wants you to walk in the ways of the Lord and follow after Him. We see that as they did this, it said that when the voice of the trumpet sounded long and waxed louder and louder, Moses spake and God answered him by a voice. He began to speak to them. God wants to speak to you. He wants to bring revelation of His ways unto you. He will speak to you with a still small voice. He will speak to you through His word and reveal the things that He wants to accomplish in your life. At the same time, we see in Exodus 19, verse 10, the Lord said to Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. Today and tomorrow is 2 days. What is that speaking of? That is speaking of the church age, which is 2,000 years. A day is as 1,000 years. Today, 1,000, tomorrow, a second 1,000. And that's what we are close to ending. We're not over ended it yet. The 2,000 years is not done yet. Jesus was resurrected and raised from the dead, and the New Testament began in 30 AD. It will not be over the 2,000 years till 2030 AD. We certainly are moving down that road, and we are certainly getting very close. And it says, let them wash their clothes and be ready against the third day. For the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. We must understand that this is all prophetic of the fact that 2 days, the 2,000 years of the church age, now it's fast approaching the day when the Lord is going to come back. And the third day, He comes in the sight of all the people, because when Jesus comes back, every eye is going to see Him. They're all going to see Him, and He's going to come down in the sight of the people, and He's going to bring forth the catching up of the church to meet Him in the air. He's going to bring the judgment upon the nations, and He's going to bring the millennial reign of Jesus Christ as He is going to now reign on earth. That is going to happen. This is all prophetic, pointing towards that. We also see, verse 14, Moses went down from the mountain of the people and sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. This speaks prophetically of what God is wanting to happen in your life. He wants you to be sanctified. He wants you to be holy. He wants you to be washed clean. Deal with all sin. Turn away from all sin in your life. Be washed clean by the blood of Jesus. Turn away from the ways of this world. Come out of the things of crucifying the flesh. Put off the deeds of the body. be holy before the Lord. We see also in this particular time, in Nehemiah chapter 8, it says in verse 1 that all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate. And they spake unto Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel. When were they doing this? They were doing this at the time of the seventh month. When you see the seventh month, it is prophetic of this last end time move of God. It is prophetic of the things that are going to happen. And so here, the seventh month came, the children of Israel were in their cities, and of course it's the time of these fall feasts of the Lord. And he says in verse 2, Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding upon the first day of the seventh month. So what day is that? That is the Feast of Trumpets. And that also is prophetic of the fact that the work of God is going to be accomplished in the body of Christ before Jesus returns. Because the Feast of Trumpets precedes the Day of Atonement, which is the Day of Judgment. And, of course, the Lord is coming back to judge those who are the ungodly. But he's come to save those and to bring us out of the evil world that we have and catch us up to meet the Lord in the air. The first day of the seventh month, it said that they came with the law, the word of God. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate from the morning till midday, before the men and women and those that could understand. And all the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. What's that tell you? These guys were reading the word for hours, hours. It said they did it from here, from the morning till midday. That'd be 5, 6, 7 hours, however long, 4 hours, 5 hours, depends on what time they started. Hours and hours of getting the word of God. That's what has to happen for the body of Christ in these last days. God wants you to get yourself in the Word of God and hear the Word of God. Learn the ways of the Lord. You need to get in the Bible. God will reveal the truths through the Holy Spirit. He'll write them in your heart, write them in your mind. He will give you knowledge. You act upon it. He'll produce a spiritual understanding and give you wisdom in your life so you will walk in the ways of the Lord. And notice the people were attentive to the book of the law. I mean, they were serious about the Word of God. They just didn't come to church, hear a couple scriptures or whatever, and then go off and do their own thing. No, these guys wanted to get the Word in them. They were hearing the Word of God. And that's what you're going to see. As we see that people who are really serious about walking with God are wanting the Word. They want to hear the Word because they know it's the Word that's going to change them. It's going to bring revelation. It's the power of God. It's going to bring healing. It's going to accomplish all the things that God purposes in their life. We see that as they were doing this. Verse 13, on the second day were gathered together the chief of the priests of all the people, the priests and the Levites and Ezra the scribe, even to understand the words of the law. I mean, they just didn't do this one day. They were doing it day after day, getting the word in them, getting the understanding. God wants you to have strong desire for the Word of God, to study it, to get that Word in you. God will give you the spiritual understanding and show you the ways of the Lord. We see something else over in Numbers in chapter 10. Numbers in chapter 10 in verse 1 and 2. The Lord spake unto Moses, saying, make thee two trumpets of silver of a whole piece that thou shalt make them. See about trumpets, it's speaking about something about the time of trumpets and the fulfillment of the work of God in the body of Christ, that thou mayest use them for the calling of the assembly and for the journeying of the camps. The calling of the assembly. What are you and I? You and I are the assembly of the believers. What is God doing? He's calling the body of Christ to come unto him, to hear the word of God. When we see many churches out there that only have one service a week, some of them, you know, they can't get the people to come, there's a problem. We should be coming more and more, as the Word of God declares. In fact, we see a scripture in the New Testament, over in Hebrews chapter 10, in verse 25, where it says this, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. That means the more we see the day approaching, which is the day of the Lord returning, the second coming of Jesus, we should be getting together more and more. What are we coming together to do? To hear the word of God, to worship him, to learn the ways of the Lord and to do the things that God commands to do. And also, they were journeying. He led them on their journey. God wants you to know, as you are hearing the word of God, he's going to be working in you. He's going to lead you. He's going to guide you. His word is going to talk to you. It's going to keep you. It's going to work in your life continually through the Holy Spirit working in you. He's going to lead you and guide you in the ways of the Lord. And as he was leading them through the wilderness was the place of testing. Every one of us are going to be tested, and we're going to be proved to see whether we're going to walk in the ways of the word of God or not. God's going to test every one of us. As we see in the Old Testament, the wilderness, when they were going through it, he talked about all the commandments that he had given them to them. And he said in Deuteronomy 8:2, "You shall remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years." 40 is the number of testing in the wilderness. To do what? To humble thee, to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldest keep the commandments or not. God's going to humble you, prove you, find out what's really in your heart, and find out whether you're going to keep the commandments of the Lord, whether you're going to walk in the ways of the Lord or not. The assembly of the saints. Instead of people coming to church less and less, no, we'll be coming more and more as we hear the word of God and learn the ways of the Lord and do the things that he has called us to do. We also see that trumpets was also a time of calling them to war. Numbers chapter 10, verse 9. "If you go to war in your land against the enemy that oppresses you, then you shall blow an alarm with the trumpets. You'll be remembered before the Lord your God. You'll be saved before from your enemies." They would blow trumpets when there was a call to war. Every one of us have been called to spiritual war. Our enemy is Satan, and he works through evil spirits that serve him. They operate in the heavenlies as principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness, spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places. And they work in the earth as evil spirits trying to get into us to carry out their destructive work. God wants us to enter into spiritual warfare to conquer the enemies in our life. We see in the New Testament, what are we told to do? We see in 1 Timothy chapter 1, over in verse 18. He says, "This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies that went before on thee, that thou mightest war a good warfare." You are going to war a good warfare, a spiritual warfare against your spiritual enemies. Remember, people are not our problem. It's the devil. And you and I have been given authority over all the power of the enemy, and you can conquer all the works of the devil in your life. This is why we're going to fight the good fight of faith, as it says. 1 Timothy 6:12, fight the good fight of faith. We're going to fight it with spiritual weapons against spiritual enemy, and God's going to do that work, of course. You're the one that simply releases him as you act upon his word. We are going to fight that good fight of faith, and we are going to engage in the warfare. We see in Ephesians chapter 6, in verse 12, the Bible says, "We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities." This is who we wrestle against. We're wrestling against these evil spirits. People are not your problem. It's the principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, against the spiritual wickedness in high places. This is why you're supposed to put on the whole armor of God, as the verse before it says, so you can stand against the wiles of the devil. And you put on the whole armor of God through the word in you, the word in your mind, the word in your mouth, the word in your heart, the word directing your steps, so you can stand against all the wiles of the devil. We're going to be able to conquer him. So we're going to engage in spiritual warfare. God has given you weapons of warfare that are mighty through God that will destroy all of the works of the devil in your life. We also are called to reach out to others and to preach the gospel. He wants every one of us to be out there preaching the gospel to others. You are called to be a watchman. Ezekiel 33, verse 6. "If the watchman see the sword come," he sees the destructive things that are coming, and there is destructive things coming on the earth. You're going to see as we go down these last days, it is not going to be an easy time. You're going to have to keep your eyes on the Lord. He will keep you in perfect peace if you will do so. At the same time, things are going to be a lot of havoc. We see things happening on the horizon. You see what's going on in the world. And as we go down, knowing what the Word says, there's going to be a lot of things that are going to be happening throughout this world. It says here, if the watchman sees the The sword come and blows not the trumpet, the people be not warned, the sword come and take any person from among them, he's taken away in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at the watchman's hand. That means the watchman, that's you all, you and me, we got to warn the wicked. We want to call them to the place of repentance so they receive Jesus and get born again. But if they resist Jesus and reject him, we have to warn them what's going to happen. Because if a person does not receive Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, at the end of their days, or if they would die, they would go to hell. They would not go to heaven. God does not want any of us to go to hell. He wants every one of us to enter into eternal life. So you and I must be the watchmen, and we're going to call people to repentance. It's paramount that we deal with our sins and we help others as we must preach the gospel. Hosea chapter 8, verse 1. He says, set the trumpet to thy mouth. He shall come. Now, trumpet here, that's speaking of something. Anytime you see trumpets, it has something to do with this Feast of Trumpets and the work of God. He shall come as an eagle against the house of the Lord. Who's the house of the Lord? The church. Because they've transgressed my covenant and trespassed against my law because of sin. That's how the enemy can come against us. Israel shall cry unto me, my God, we know thee. Israel's a type of the church. You and I are the spiritual Israel. Jews now are one who's inwardly, not one who's outwardly, which is you and me, as it says in Romans 2, 28 and 29. My God, we know thee. Israel hath cast off the thing that's good. What'd they do? They cast off the word. If we don't walk in the ways of the word, and we don't obey what he says, what's going to happen? The enemy shall pursue him and carry out destruction. God wants us to understand that trumpets is ultimately about the catching up of the church to meet the Lord in the air, but it's also prophetic of the work of God to be accomplished in the church, where now we are going to meet God, we're going to hear him, we're going to wash ourselves, get clean, we're going to come to the assembly of the saints to hear the word of God so we grow in the things of God. We're going to be led in the ways of the Lord, and God's going to prove us and test us to find out if we're going to walk in his ways or not. We're also going to be those that are going to engage in spiritual warfare and conquer the enemies in our life and help conquer the enemies in other people's lives and destroy the work of the enemy in the spirit. We are going to be the watchmen that are going to preach the gospel to others and calling them to repentance so that they walk in the ways of the Lord. The second one is that at this time is the Day of Atonement. In Leviticus chapter 23, the Day of Atonement, we pick up here in verse 27. The Day of Atonement is on the 10th day of the 7th month. It says also, on the 10th day of the 7th month, there shall be a Day of Atonement. This particular word, atonement, actually, in the Hebrew, means to cover or to atone by offering a substitute, to cover something over. And that's what the Day of Atonement in the Old Testament was, a covering over for sin until Jesus came, who was going to take away the sin of the world. The high priest on the Day of Atonement had to go in to the Holy of Holies and put the blood on the mercy seat, which was a covering over for the sins of the people. He didn't wash it away. Nobody could have that happen in the Old Testament until Jesus came. But it was a covering over. It had to happen on that day because the Day of Atonement was the day of judgment. It was the day of judgment. It's also known as the day of the national sanctuary cleansing. This is the day called Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. This is the time of when the judgment was going to come if they were not covered over in the Old Testament, or if they were not right before God. Well, we know, of course, that Jesus is the one who has, of course, paid the price for our sins. Now we can be right before him. So what's the application of the Day of Atonement now for us? His application is the work of God that is being done in the church also to get us ready for the coming of the Lord, and also showing us that there is a day of judgment that's going to come. It is the day of the Lord when he is going to come and he's going to judge the nations and he's going to bring the judgment upon all those that have rejected him. At the same time, we see it shall be a holy convocation, that you shall afflict your souls, it says in verse 27, and offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. Otherwise, they had to deal with their souls to get right before God. They do no work on that day, a day of atonement, to make an atonement for you before the Lord. Whatever soul it be that shall not be afflicted on that in that day, he shall be cut off from among his people. Otherwise, they had to get holy before the Lord, or they're going to be cut off. Whatsoever soul be that doeth any work on that day, the same soul will I destroy from among the people. If you do any manner of work, it shall be a statute forever throughout your generations and all your dwellings. It shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest, and you shall afflict your souls on the ninth day of the month, at even from even to even shall you celebrate your Sabbath. Now this is the time where there was a time of fasting. They would fast for that 24-hour period. And it was a time of dealing with their souls so that they were right before the Lord, so that they would not be judged. And what does that speak to us? The Bible declares that you and I are to judge ourselves so we won't be judged. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 31 says, if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. If we will judge ourselves and deal with all sin and confess our sin and repent and turn from it, we won't be judged. But there is a judgment coming. We must be sure that we're right before the Lord so we do not have any evil effects coming upon us, because we must conquer all areas of sin. God wants you to walk in holiness before him. In Leviticus chapter 16, when we see when it speaks here of when Aaron was going to go in and do this, because only the high priest could enter in, which is all typifying only Jesus could pour out his blood on the mercy seat, which he did in accomplishing the redemption. But here it speaks of, in verse 3, Aaron will come into the holy place with a young bullock for a sin offering, a ram for a burnt offering, and he shall put on the holy linen coat. He shall have the linen breeches upon his flesh, shall be girded with a linen girdle, and with a linen mitre shall he be attired. These are holy garments. Therefore shall he wash his flesh in water, and so put them on. Notice he was to be washed. God wants you to be washed by confessing your sins and receiving forgiveness and cleansing from all unrighteousness. He wants you to put on these linen garments, all these different things. Notice every one of them is linen. What does linen mean? Well, we must understand that linen, as we see in Revelation chapter 19, over in verse 8, it says, to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen. What is something that's linen? Clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. So if we're going to be putting on these linen garments, what are we going to be doing? We're going to put on righteousness. God wants you to put on righteous garments. He wants you to have the fruits of righteousness in your life. He wants you to walk in the way of the Lord. And this is so important, because you must understand, this is the day of judgment, remember? And many people think that, well, the judgment's going to come to the world and that's the way it's going to be. But they fail to understand there is a judgment that is coming to the church before it comes to the world. Look what it says in 1 Peter 4:17. The time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. What's the house of God? That's the church. And if it first begin at us, what shall be the end of them that obey not the gospel of God? Those that don't obey the gospel, those that have rejected Jesus, that are not born again. Of course, you know they're in trouble. They're going to be in big trouble. If the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? It's interesting that this word scarcely is a word which means with difficulty and not easily, which means it's not a cakewalk to walk the way of the Lord. Because the devil will test you every step of the way, tempting you and trying to get you to walk in sin. And you have this body of death that is continually working against you, this flesh that will not want to walk in the ways of the Lord either. That's why you've got to get your mind renewed to the Word so you can walk in the Spirit and follow the way of the Lord. So God wants us to walk that walk. We can overcome. Your spirit, if you walk by your spirit, you will. Your spirit is always ready and willing to do the right thing. Your flesh has no strength whatsoever. And there's a battle between your spirit and your flesh. You're to walk in the Spirit so you don't fulfill the lusts of the flesh. That's why you've got to crucify the flesh daily. You cannot let your body run you, or your feelings, or carnal mind, or anything that is of the flesh. You must walk in line with the Word of God. It is absolutely mandatory. So righteousness is going to come forth. We must realize also that if we walk in the ways of sin, we're going to be judged. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26 says, if we sin willfully after we receive the knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sins. No. What's going to happen? But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which will devour the adversaries. Does God want us to have that kind of a judgment? No. Remember, if we'll judge ourselves, we won't be judged. And he says, he that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. And judgment really came on them. And he goes on and says, of how much sore punishment, suppose you, thought he be thought worthy. We would be worthy of even worse punishment, he says, who has done three things, trodden underfoot the Son of God, hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and done despite, which means insult, under the Spirit of grace. How do we trodden underfoot the Son of God? The Son of God is Jesus, and Jesus is the Word. If you don't put the Word of God first place and do what it says, you're casting His Word aside or putting it under your foot and just not putting it as the rule of authority in your life. You and I have come into a covenant relationship if you're born again, and the Word is the Word of the covenant. God wants you to walk according to that ways. It is a law of liberty that will bring victory in your life. But if you don't, you're going to see the enemy have place, as he's the accuser of the brethren, and all curses of destruction will come upon you. And we're essentially trodding underfoot the Son of God if we don't walk in line with the Word. And counted the blood of the covenant. He was sanctified an unholy thing. You've got to realize the blood has to do with your relationship with God. When you confess your sins, the blood of Jesus cleanses you from all unrighteousness. When you walk in the light, as He is in the light, the blood of Jesus Christ continually keeps you cleansed from all sin. He applies it. It all has to do with the relationship with Him. Well, if we're walking the ways of sin, the blood of Jesus is not going to be applied, and we've counted it like an unholy thing. It means nothing to us. No. Without the blood of Jesus applied by Jesus, you have no relationship with Him, because the blood of Jesus is what washes away your sins and is done despite or insult of the Spirit of grace. We can't insult the Holy Spirit, who is at work to bring God's grace, His favor to us. He wants to bring blessings to us. See, this is what happens when we walk in sin. We're insulting Him because there's a way of grace that's opened up to us. The grace of God, the favor of God's available for every one of us. We can come boldly to the throne of grace and take hold of mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. How can we reject His ways? How can we turn away from the things that He has for us? It's interesting, in Hebrews 2:1 it says, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things we've heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, because God is a just God. He wants you blessed, and He will bless you when you walk in His ways. But if you don't, you're choosing the way that's going to bring judgment and destructive effects. He goes on and says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? We aren't going to escape if we reject the salvation of the Lord, if we neglect the things that He says. God wants us to choose the way of the Lord and be obedient to Him. We also must understand that we are to be righteous, we are to be holy before the Lord. We know the fact that over in 1 John chapter 3, verse 7, the Bible says this, little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. Why would he be warning us about being deceived? Because this is a subject where God, knowing in his foreknowledge that people would be deceived about righteousness. The prevailing teaching in the body of Christ is, once you're born again, you're perfectly righteous. And you're righteous before God. Well, that's not accurate. Because righteousness is more than just getting born again. You have to get born again to get a new spirit that's right with Him. But righteousness is more than that. Suppose you walk in sin. What does that produce? Unrighteousness. And if you walk in sin, are you righteous now? No, you got unrighteousness upon you. That's why he says, let no man deceive you about this. He that doeth righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. The word doeth is a present tense verb. We can show you the tense, voice, and mood of verbs in this program we have. And it's very important to understand what's being said if you're here for the first time. The present tense in the Greek means continuous, repeated, ongoing action. So what it's saying is, he that who is doing continuously. Young's literal translation brings out the meaning of this very well when it says is doing, showing the ongoing action. He who is doing righteousness is righteous. That means your walk really counts. God wants us to be doing the word of righteousness and walking in the ways of the Lord. He also has called us to be holy, because the people had to be holy, because it was judgment day coming. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15. He which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. The word conversation doesn't just mean your talk. It's a word which means your manner of life, conduct, and behavior. Otherwise, everything you do. God wants you holy in everything that you do. Be holy as he is holy. He goes on and says that it's written, be holy for I am holy. God would never tell us to be something if we couldn't be that. Say, well, God's holy. I understand that. How could I be holy? Because God's going to do that work and make you holy. He will accomplish that work as you do what the Word of God says. And he wants every one of us to come to that place. In fact, we even see the scripture in 1 Thessalonians 5, in verse 23, where it says, the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, W-H-O-L-L-Y, referring to the whole person. And I pray God your whole spirit and soul, not just your spirit only, when you get a new spirit, it's right with God, but also your soul and your body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The coming is the parousia, which is the second coming of Jesus. God wants us to be blameless. How is it going to happen? Because we're going to be sanctified, spirit, soul, and body. Another thing about atonement is this is the day when there was to be liberty proclaimed to all, because everybody was to come out of bondage. Freedom was declared. Leviticus 25, verse 9. It speaks of the trumpet of the Jubilee sounding. And this was on the 10th day, it says. Thus shall cause the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month. In the Day of Atonement shall you make the trumpet sound throughout all your land. So here was the trumpet sound declaring freedom and liberty on the 7th day, because that's what also atonement's about. It's about you coming to the place of holiness, which means you've got to come out of all bondage. God wants you healed and delivered. He wants you set free from everything in your life. He goes on and he says, you shall hallow the 50th year, proclaim liberty throughout all the land and to all the inhabitants thereof. Liberty. Jesus comes to bring you liberty. It shall be a jubilee unto you, and you return every man into his possession, and he shall return every man into his family. He's not bound by anybody any longer. Otherwise, that prophetically talks about we're coming out of all bondage. All the debts are going to be eliminated. We're going to be returned back, and we're not going to be in bondage any longer. So the Jubilee was proclaimed, the time of freedom and liberty. And we see over in Luke chapter 4, when Jesus began his ministry, and we see in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, he stood up at Nazareth to read, and he got this from the scroll of Isaiah. And he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. What's the acceptable year of the Lord? The year of Jubilee. The year of Jubilee. Everybody goes free every 50 years. That was the way it was. Well, who's our Jubilee now? Jesus is our Jubilee, and he has fulfilled this, because he is the one, as it says, he's preaching, hey, the acceptable year of the Lord is here. I am your Jubilee, and I am come to set you free. And so what's he come to do? He's going to preach the gospel to us so we can receive the good news. Gospel means the good news of what Jesus has accomplished. We can be born again. We can be saved from our sins. We can be healed and delivered. We can be healed of brokenheartedness. He'll bring deliverance to the captives and cast out the evil spirits, recovering of sight to the blind, set at liberty, release from bondage and imprisonment, all those that are bruised. If you've been hurt, damaged, wounded, bruised, God wants you delivered and healed and restored. Healing and deliverance is available for us in the New Testament through Jesus Christ, and he will set us free. Now, it's interesting also, if we go back to Isaiah 61, where he was reading that from, something important that we need to see. Because he was reading from Isaiah, but he stopped and didn't read all that was there because Jesus came in his first coming to save us, to heal us, and to deliver us. But I want you to look at what he was reading from. Isaiah 61, verse 1 and 2 says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because he's anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek, sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, proclaim liberty to the captives, open the prison of them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." That's what all Jesus said, and then he stopped there. "And the day of vengeance of our God." What's that all about? The day of vengeance is the day of atonement, fulfillment, which is the judgment that is going to come upon the nations. The day of vengeance, God's vengeance, is that he is going to punish those who have rejected him and have refused to walk in his ways and have rebelled against him. And there is going to be a judgment upon the nations, especially when these ones follow the Antichrist and they accept him as the true and living God, which will be a great mistake, and they're going to be sunk. Anybody that takes the mark in the tribulation period, they're finished. They are going to be eliminated. The day of vengeance of our God. So we see that, again, day of atonement, what's it all about? It's to bring us to the place of being holy before God, righteous before God, deal with all areas of sin. It was the time of fasting and prayer, the time that afflicted their soul. They had to deal with their sin. They had to come to the place of being right before the Lord. And they also were coming out of all bondage into liberty. That all prophetically speaks of the fact that the church is going to come to the place of being holy, walking in righteousness, walking in the ways of the Lord, conquering every enemy, overcoming everything before Jesus comes back. Because this all precedes him before he comes. It's all typifying this. And he's here to heal you, to deliver you, to set you free, to restore you in all areas. And he wants you to come to the place of being holy. We see in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. Having these promises, dearly beloved, we have these great promises in the New Testament. Remember, we're under a better covenant with better promises. "Let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit." Whose responsibility is it? Yours and mine. I have to cleanse myself. You've got to cleanse yourself. How am I going to do it? By God's power. He's going to do the work as I do what he says. "From all filthiness of the flesh." We're going to get rid of all this filthiness of the flesh. "And spirit," which is all the evil spirits that have come into us from inheritance, our own sins, or victimization. We can cast them all out and get set free. And what's going to be the result? We're going to perfect holiness in the fear of God. Holiness in the fear of God. That's what we need. And that's what God is going to bring forth. And what else? He's going to bring the church to the place of perfection. The Bible declares it. It says in Hebrews 6:1, "Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on into perfection." The body of Christ is to go on into perfection in the Lord. And you're going to see that the full man of the stature in Christ is going to come forth in these last days. Because what type of a church is Jesus going to present to himself? It's not going to be one that's all full of sin and all these negative things. No. Ephesians 5:27 says when he comes back, what's going to happen? He's going to present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but it should be holy and without blemish. We're going to be without spot, without blemish, holy before the Lord. God's going to do that work in you as you do what the Word says. He will deliver you, heal you, restore you. You're going to come out of all bondage, come into the place of liberty in the Lord, because the day of vengeance is going to come and is going to bring destruction. The next feast is the Feast of Tabernacles. We go back to Leviticus. The Feast of Tabernacles is the third feast. This one occurs on the 15th day of the seventh month. Otherwise, the first day of the seventh month was the Feast of Trumpets. 10 days later, on the Day of Atonement, that's the Day of Judgment. 5 days later begins the Feast here of Tabernacles. He says in verse 34, speaking of the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the seventh month shall be the Feast of Tabernacles for 7 days. So this Feast of Tabernacles, the word tabernacle means God's going to come and tabernacle among us. Do you know that there's already been a fulfillment of this already? There was a fulfillment of this already by Jesus Christ. How? The fulfillment came when he was born. When was Jesus born? He was born at the time of tabernacles. Not on December 25th, that's for sure. John chapter 1, verse 14 even reveals this. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. He talks about how he comes. And so it says the Word was made flesh and dwelt. The word dwelt means to tabernacle. It's to tabernacle. That's what the word means in the Greek. Well, that's a sure key sign. Guess when he came and he was born? Tabernacles. How else do we know that? Well, if we take a look at Luke chapter 2, we can know pretty quickly. It came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. When was the Roman tax? It was in the fall of the year right after the harvest, when they got all their money in, which would have been the September or October time. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. All went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. Okay? So Joseph went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, the city of David called Bethlehem. He was the house and lineage of David. They had to go back to their city to be taxed, see? To be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. That meant she was about to deliver. So when was Jesus born? The time of the tax. The time of the tax was in the fall of the year. So while it was they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laying him in a manger. Why? Because there was no room for them in the inn. No room in the inn. Well, that meant all the rooms were taken. What was the big deal about all the rooms were taken? Because everybody was there for tabernacles, and all the rooms were taken. You see, you must understand that the rainy season in Israel begins in November up to the time of February, and they did not travel much during those times. December 25th is in the middle of that. December 25th has nothing to do with the birthday of Jesus. It was a day appointed by the Roman Catholic Church as the birthday of Jesus, bringing a merging together of paganism and Christianity in a state church that Constantine was proclaiming in 312 AD, which was a compromise, of course, pleasing the pagans so they'd all be happy about it. But is that the birth of Jesus? No. This was the birth of the unconquered sun god that they were worshiping. It's all about paganism. So, we also see, they're in the same country, shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. The shepherds had their sheep out in the field until the rainy season. Then they brought them in. They were still out in the field. So this is prior to the rainy season. Jesus was born at the time of tabernacles. That was the time he came to tabernacle among us. That was the first fulfillment. The second fulfillment will be when he comes back, his second coming. He is going to come, and tabernacle means he's now going to come and tabernacle among us, and he's going to set up the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. Now, going back over here to Leviticus 23. This Feast of Tabernacles, it has a prophetic point regarding what's going to happen in the church. It speaks of this holy convocation. It speaks of the fact that it was a solemn assembly before God, and they were going to offer up all these offerings unto God. And it says in the 15th day of the seventh month, when you've gathered in the fruit of the land, you shall keep a feast in the Lord 7 days. So this is the time of the gathering of the fruit into the land. In fact, some places, Exodus, it talks about it's how it's called the fruit of the ingathering. Otherwise, it's the feast of the ingathering where they bring in the fruit. So this is the fruit being brought in, as we see, and we'll talk about that in a moment. And then it talks about all these trees, branches, the goodly trees, the branches of the palm trees, the boughs of the thick trees, the willow of the brook. Rejoice before the Lord. You and I are the trees of righteousness, and this speaks about things that are going to be accomplished in us. Keeps a feast unto the Lord 7 days. It'll be a statute forever, and you'll celebrate it in the seventh month. And they would also dwell in booths. These booths was the word sukkah, or sukkot, they call them, which is a temporary shelter. Why were they doing that? Because it was a temporary dwelling place, because you're not going to stay there long. Remember when they came out of Egypt, they stayed in temporary dwelling places because they were going to move on into the promised land. They weren't going to stay in that. You and I are in temporary dwelling place. What's our temporary dwelling place? In this physical body. This is a temporary dwelling place. You're going to get a new body, a new glorified body if you're born again and right with God. You're going to have a new glorified body, and we are going to live with the Lord, and we are going to be, when the Father comes back after the 1,000-year millennial reign of Jesus, the heavens and earth is going to be eliminated. There'll be a brand new one, and the holy city of Jerusalem is going to come, and the Father is going to come and dwell with us, and we're going to be with Him forever. We're going to have a new dwelling place. We're going to have a new body. It was all signifying these things. But at the same time, remember it was the time here of when it was going to be fruitful. They're going to bring in this harvest from all the crops. Well, we must realize in Deuteronomy 32, it speaks here. He says, give ear, in verse 1, O ye heavens, I'll speak and hear, O earth, the words of my mouth. My doctrine shall drop as the rain, my speech shall distill as the dew, as a small rain upon the tender herb, and as the showers upon the grass. The rain is going to come. What does the rain do? The rain comes to ripen the crops to get them ready for the harvest. The rain is coming to the body of Christ, which is God bringing forth His Word, His true doctrine, the Word of God, to teach us the truth, the way of the Lord, so we will walk in the way of the Lord and come to the place of being fruitful and being ready for the harvest that is going to come forth. It's His Word that is going to come forth mightily in these last days. In Isaiah chapter 55, we see over in verse 10, as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be. The word's like rain coming that goes out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void. It shall prosper. It will accomplish what I please and prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. God's word is coming to you to cause you to grow up in the ways of God, to bring forth fruit, more fruit, much fruit in your life as you go through the purging process and come to abide in Him and walk in His ways. That's why God wants us to get in the word of God. When you get the word in you and the rain is coming, it's going to bring the favor of God to you in your life. Over in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 15, it says, in the light of the king's countenance is life, and his favor is as a cloud of the latter rain. The latter rain is that end time rain being poured out on the church. There's a rain that is coming, because the church is to be taught the truth of the Word of God and to come to the place of walking in the ways of the Lord and to be fruitful, so they're going to be ready for the harvest. It's like the cloud of the latter rain that is going to, that is coming. Jeremiah chapter 5, verse 24. Neither say there in their heart, let us now fear the Lord our God that giveth rain, both the former and the latter in His season. You see, the double portion rain is coming to the church, because the glory of God is going to be a double portion glory on the end time church. It's going to be double of what was on the early church. It'd be greater than it, see? He reserved unto us the appointed weeks of the harvest. So this rain is coming to bring forth the harvest. And that's what God wants. The rain is going to come forth. We see over in Joel. In Joel chapter 2, in verse 22, this is also prophetic of the end times, because we see back in chapter 1, when everything was in desolation, he said, blow the trumpet in Zion, sound alarm in my holy mountain, let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, it is nigh at hand. That speaks of the day of atonement, the day of judgment coming. Sound the alarm. And we see it again in verse 15. We sing this song. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. Everybody's got to get right. It's time. The fast and the solemn assembly speaks of what Day of Atonement's all about prophetically. Time to clean up, get holy, get righteous, be right before the Lord, because the judgment is coming. Verse 22, be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree, and you and I are the trees of righteousness. The tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine tree do yield her strength. That shows you the fig tree, Israel, the Jews, there's going to be a mighty move for them before the end comes, and they're going to be saved. And the vine is Jesus, and that speaks of the church. The fig tree and the vine, they're both going to yield their strength because they're going to have great fruitfulness that's going to come forth. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, rejoice in the Lord your God, for he's given you the former rain moderately, and he'll cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first, it literally means. Now, one thing you have to understand about this rain, when we put the cursor over the word rain, you have to look at these words up. You can't trust the translations. It is a word which refers to the teacher rain. The teacher rain. Because the rain, remember, is the word, the doctrine coming to teach us. It is the teacher rain. And he will cause for you to come down this rain, this teacher rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first. So there's going to be an outpouring of the Word of God through the teaching, accurate teaching, not the false teachers, false prophets, false stuff that's out there, a lot of it. But we're talking about the true teaching of the Scriptures that is going to bring forth the revelation of the truth. What's going to happen? There's going to be great fruitfulness. Because look what it says. The floors will be full of wheat. The vats will overflow with wine and oil. That's the produce of all the fruit. Hey, this thing's overflowing. Full of wheat. Overflowing with wine and oil. That means great fruitfulness is going to come forth. It is going to come in the body of Christ. We're not holding on until Jesus comes. We're going to grow up in all things, and we're going to be walking in the ways of the Lord, and we're going to be a part of the end time mighty church, the glorious church. Jeremiah 31:10 says, hear the word of the Lord, O ye nations. Declare it in the isles afar off and say, he that scattered Israel will gather him and keep him as the shepherd doth his flock. For the Lord hath redeemed Jacob and has ransomed him from the hand of him that was stronger than he. Therefore they shall come and sing in the heights of Zion and shall flow together to the goodness of the Lord for wheat, wine, and the oil. That's all the harvest coming forth. For the young flock and the herd, and their soul shall be a watered garden. And they shall not sorrow anymore. Water means saturated or satiated garden. I mean, they are not going to be dried up any longer. No, they're not going to sorrow anymore, as it says. The virgin will rejoice in the dance, the young men and old together. I'll turn their mourning into joy and comfort them, make them rejoice from their sorrow. God's going to turn all these things around. And he goes on and says, I'll satiate the soul of the priest with fatness. That's good. And my people should be satisfied with my goodness, saith the Lord. Otherwise, God's goodness, his blessings are going to come to the people that are going to walk in the ways of the Lord. We also see something else. This is harvest time, see? You and I are going to grow up in all the things of God. We also see over in Haggai chapter 1, verse 12. This is talking about Zerubbabel and Joshua, who was the son of the high priest, with all the remnant of the people. And notice, it says they obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the words of Haggai the prophet as the Lord had sent him, and the people did fear before the Lord. This is something that is prophetic for the end time church, as you'll see, because it talks about it when we come up here in chapter 2, in the seventh month, in the 1 20th day, which is the end of the free Feast of Tabernacles, because it goes from the 15th to the 21st day. So this is prophetic of the end time work in the church. What's going to happen? Unfortunately, there's only going to be a remnant, because there's going to be a falling away. It is not the will of God for anybody to fall away, but it's been declared and prophesied that there will be a falling away. But there'll be a remnant who are going to walk the walk. They're going to walk with the Lord. Remember, few are going to be walking the right way, and the broad is the way to destruction. That's the many out there. Now the remnant are going to be the few. What are they going to do? They're going to obey the voice of the Lord. God wants us to be obedient to His word, because that's what will bring blessings in your life. And also to have the fear of God before us. We're going to fear the Lord. Where we have the fear of the Lord, you're going to depart from evil. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. You're not going to walk in the ways of sin, because you know if I walk in the ways of sin, I'm going to give place to the devil, and I'm going to see all kinds of destructive things, and I won't be right with God. And when judgment comes, I'm going to be in trouble. No. Because remember, judgment's coming to the church first before it comes to the world. That's why the judgment's coming to the church. Is going to find out who's going to walk with Him and who's not going to walk with Him before it comes to the world. What else do we see? He speaks to them and He says here that I am with you. The Lord will be with us, the ones who are following Him. And He says He stirred these ones up. The spirit of all the remnant gets stirred up. And they come and did work in the house of the Lord. The house of the Lord is what you and I are. You're going to do work in you, and you're going to do work in the church. You're going to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, and you're going to do the works of God in the body of Christ, carrying out the gifts and the callings that God has upon you for your life. He has works for you to do. He has a ministry for you to carry out. He wants to use you, and you do great things in you and through you. God has great things for you. And so, the seventh month now, he comes and he says, again to the residue, and this happens to be the remnant, again, the remnant. He speaks to him and he says, who's left among you that saw this house in her first glory? What house is it talking about that had the glory of God? The first church, the early church, had the glory of God manifest. And he's talking about the house. The house prophetically is talking about the church, because we are the spiritual house of God. How do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing? That's the way the church has been, and that's the way it still is. But there's going to be a mighty move of God that's going to come forth before the end comes. The true teaching of the Word of God is going to come forth, and the people of God are going to grow up, and we're going to walk in His ways, and we're going to be holy before Him. He says, be strong, O Zerubbabel, strong, O Joshua. Be strong, all ye people of the land. That's another thing. God's going to bring you and me to the place of spiritual strength. How do you get strong? Through the Word. You get strong by putting on the whole armor of God, and through the Word in you will produce the spiritual strength in your life. You've got to understand, God's Word is the power of God that will produce everything that He says in your life. God's Word comes into your heart, and it comes into your mind when you hear it. The devil wants to take it out if you don't do it, but if you will hear and do the word, the power of God will be resident in you, and it will produce the promises of God in your life. That's why the devil attacks the word in your life. He knows what the word will do. That's why you got to guard yourself with all diligence. You cannot let the enemy take that word out of your heart. You got to keep doing the word. How do you keep it? By doing the word and not giving place to sin. And he also says you're going to get strong and you're going to work. Yeah, you're going to be a workman for the Lord. We're not going to be ashamed. We're going to work out our own salvation. We're going to do the mighty works of the Lord. He says, again, I'm with you. The Lord's going to be with those that are meeting these conditions. And notice, what have we seen so far when we look at these conditions? We're seeing these guys were obedient. They had the fear of God before them. These guys were ones who were working in the house of the Lord. These are guys who, they were coming to the place of being strong in the Lord, and working for Him, working out their own salvation. And he talks, says also, according to the word that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, Egypt's a type of the world. We're not going to walk in the ways of the world any longer. So my spirit remaineth among you. Fear not. Fear you not. You can't be afraid. Fear will open the door to the enemy. That's what happened to Job. The thing that he greatly feared came upon him. God says continually throughout the word, fear not, fear not, fear not. We're not going to have fear. We're going to get rid of it. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once, it's a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. You think you see some things going on now? You see nothing compared to what's going to happen. There is going to be such a shaking that the Bible even says in Luke 21 that men's hearts will fail for fear of the things they see coming on the earth. You've got to get prepared and strong in the Lord and focused upon Him and not be moved by what's going to come down these days, because it's going to happen. And you're going to see all these things happen in the earth. I will shake all nations. Everything's going to be shaken. And the desire of all nations, the desire is really Jesus, shall come. He's going to come to every nation to see whether they're going to walk with Him or not. Some nations will be saved. That's why we continually pray for this nation to get right again and to be saved. I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. That's the end time church. The silver's mine, the gold's mine, saith the Lord of hosts. That means, hey, that sounds like the end time wealth is going to come into the church, because the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. For what? For me to have a big house and go six cars and all these things and yachts? No. For the propagation of the gospel. That's what God wants. It's going to come to those people who use it right. The glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former. That's the end time church. That is what is going to happen. The glory of the latter house will be greater. It's going to be mighty. We're going to be mighty and powerful. He said, in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. Now that's for the remnant. The rest of the ones that fall away, they're in trouble. They are going to have all kinds of problems. But also a couple other things we want to look at before we conclude for tonight that are important. It says over in Psalms 65, in verse 9, thou visitest the earth and waterest it. Thou greatly enriched it with the river of God, which is full of water. Thou preparest him corn that thou hast so provided for it. Thou waterest the ridges thereof abundantly. Thou settlest the furrows thereof. Thou makest it soft with showers. Thou blessest the springing thereto. This shows you that the river of God is going to come. The river of God is that which is spiritual, which is going to come into the church. Psalms 46. Verse 4, there is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God. Who's the city of God? That's the church again, type of that. And what is this? Where is this going to manifest, these streams, this river? The holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. Ah, tabernacles. Tabernacles is going to see the fulfillment of the river of God coming into the church. The river of God is going to come to us. We even see in John chapter 7, Jesus even spoke about this, these rivers coming into us, when he said over here in verse 37, last day, the great day of the feast. What's he talking about? This is the Feast of Tabernacles. The reason we know this, if we actually go back here to John chapter 7, it says in verse 2, now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. The Tabernacles Feast. And it's interesting that it says when the brethren went up to the feast, he said, my time's not yet come, but your time's always ready. We can go into the things of God, but Jesus' time wasn't ready to come back. He's going to come back, but it wasn't time yet. Now, at the same time, you must understand that before Jesus comes for the church, He's coming in the church to teach the church so the church will grow up and walk in His ways to bring it to the fulfillment. He says, go ye up unto this feast. I go not up yet unto this feast, for my time is not yet full come. So, then it's very interesting what it says in verse 10. When His brethren were gone up, then went He also up into the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. This is how he came to the Feast of Tabernacles. What is that prophetic of? This is how he's going to come to the church in the end times. He's not going to come to some big open wide great earth-shaking revival. Instead, it's going to become like in secret. Because he's coming into every church, he's coming to every believer's house, he's coming to every one of us to find out, are we going to walk in the way of the Lord or not? He's not coming openly. He's coming, as if it were, in secret. And what's he coming to do? What did he do at this feast? He comes up here, in the midst of the feast, Jesus went up in the temple and he taught. Because the teaching reign has to come to the church. And it's going to come. We are going to be taught the ways of the Word of God. And we come down to verse 37, at the last great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried. That would mean this isn't at the end of Tabernacles, so this is prophetic of the end of the work of God that gets accomplished in the church at the very end, right before Jesus comes back. So that's telling you this is going to culminate in the great work of Jesus being accomplished in the church right before he comes back. Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Well, it's got to be in you to come out of you. Rivers of living water are going to come out of the church in these last days. And we see this spoken of prophetically over in Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 47. You must understand this is coming to the church. Afterward, in verse 1, he says, afterward he brought me again into the door of the house, and behold, the waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward. He saw this house, he saw these waters. For the forefront of the house stood straight toward the east, the waters came down from under it from the right side of the house at the south side of the altar. Then he brought me out of the way of the gate northward, led me about the way without unto the utter gate by the way that looked eastward. Behold, there ran out waters on the right side. So we see this house, which is all a type of the church, these waters are coming out from it. I meant there's waters that are going to be in it. And so with these waters, he begins to measure these waters now. And it says the waters were to the ankles. It's coming into us. It's starting to fill us up. Measured 1,000, brought me into the waters, and now the waters were to the knees. He measured again, and now the waters were the loins. It's rising. It's going to rise in the full man of the stature in Christ. The full man of the stature of Christ is going to come. And now he measures it, and it was a river that I could not pass over, for the waters are risen, waters to swim, and a river that could not be passed over. You're going to be filled with the rivers of living water, filled to capacity, overflowing you, coming out of the church. Son of man, hast thou seen this? He brought me and returned me to the brink of the river. And he returned, behold, the bank of the river were many trees on one side and on the other. These waters issue out toward the east country, go down to the desert, go to the seas. They be being brought forth to the sea, the waters shall be healed. It will come to pass that everything that liveth, which moveth, whithersoever the river shall come, that's God's rivers coming out of us, shall live. And there shall be a very great multitude of fish. What's that speak of? Catching fish, that's the people getting born again. The spiritual harvest, the people coming to the Lord. Because these waters shall come hither, for they shall be healed, and everything shall live where the river cometh. The glory of God's going to be on the church. The rivers of living water are going to come out of it. There's going to be a great move of God to reach people, great numbers of people coming to the Lord, being born again. It is going to be a glorious church before the end comes. At the same time, the world is going to be crazy and everything's going to be going absolutely out of control in the world at the same time before the end comes. It will come to pass that the fishers shall stand upon it from En-Gedi and the Eneglam, they shall be a place to spread their nets. Their fish shall be according to their kinds, as the fish of the great sea, exceeding many. Great harvest is coming. The miry place thereof and the marshes shall not be healed. They shall be given to salt. The river upon the bank thereof on the side and on that side shall grow all trees for meat, whose leaf shall not fade, neither shall for the fruit thereof be consumed. It shall bring forth new fruit according to his months, because their water issued out of the sanctuary. So where's this issue coming out? The sanctuary. Who's the sanctuary? Where's the temple? Who's the temple of the living God? We are. Who's the sanctuary of God? We are. It's got to be built in you. You got to build your spiritual house and get full of all the things of God, because the waters are coming into you, and you're going to be a river of living waters. The waters issued out of the sanctuary, and the fruit thereof shall be for meat, and the leaf thereof for medicine. You're going to see the power of God work mighty to bring forth salvation, healing, deliverance, mighty, glorious church before the end comes. Jesus is coming back for a glorious church. Two more scriptures. Revelation. Revelation chapter 20, verse 6. It speaks here, after Jesus comes back, we're caught up to meet the Lord in the air. The judgment comes on the nations. Tabernacles, Jesus comes to start the millennial reign. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. You want to be sure you're right with God, so you're with him, and you reign. And that's why you want to do everything God wants you to do, so you grow up in all things, because we're training for reigning. This isn't just making it through. God wants you to grow up in everything of the Lord and walk in his ways, so you learn to reign. You're to reign through Jesus Christ. We're to be reigning. So, you know, if you hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant, have authority over 10 cities, that means you've done pretty good. We got to be about the business of doing what the Lord wants. Forget about all these things of the world. Separate yourself from the things of this world. Crucify the flesh. Get out of all the worldly sin things. Get out of every bondage. Get every demon cast out. Take hold of healing. Do everything God wants. He wants you to rise up. Do not let anything pull you into the ways of the flesh or the sin or the world. No. It's all going down. The world's going to pass away, remember. You don't want to be in that crowd. Revelation 21. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. See, that's the fulfillment when Jesus comes back and rules and reigns for 1,000 years. And here's the final fulfillment. I saw a heaven, new heaven and a new earth. Revelation 21, verse 1. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. There was no more sea. There won't be any more sea after all that's eliminated. They'll all be burned up. They'll just be a heaven and an earth. And I, John saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God. That's the third fulfillment of tabernacles. First, birth of Jesus. Second coming of Jesus. Third, the tabernacle of God is with men. And he will dwell with them and shall be his people. And God himself, God the Father, shall be with them and shall be their God. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. No more death, neither sorrow nor crying. There'll be any more pain. The former things are passed away. It's all going to be gone. We're going to live with the Father and with Jesus throughout eternity. Boy, we've got to be right with God. Anybody that's not born again is not thinking right. Anybody that's walking in the ways of sin is not thinking right. Anybody that's dabbling one foot in the world and one foot in God is not thinking right. Anybody that's lukewarm is going to get spewed out of his mouth. They're not thinking right. You and I need to commit our lives to walk in the ways of the Lord. Get in the Word and grow up in all things. Commit your life to walk with him. God will do great things in your life. And you're going to be in this remnant as you do what he says. That's going to come to the place of seeing the fulfillment of the personal aspect of the feast of the Lord in our life, to bring us to be a part of the glorious church, holy, righteous, doing the things of God, works of God, living waters, rivers coming out of us in these last days. It's going to be glorious. Praise God. It's wonderful what we see, because it's not just the second coming of Jesus, the trumpet, or the judgment, and then the millennial reign of Jesus. No, it's all the things he's also going to do in the church to bring us to that place. That's why you want to make Jesus Lord of all. Say with me, this with me. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the revelation of the feast of the Lord. I thank you that Jesus fulfilled the first four in his first coming. There's three more, which will be fulfilled on their exact day by Jesus Christ in his second coming. I thank you that I see the work of God to be done in me through what trumpets typifies and the Day of Atonement and tabernacles. I am going to wash my clothes and get cleansed from all sin. I'm going to get in the Word and do what the Word says. I'm going to walk in the assembly of the saints. I'll be coming to church every time I can come to hear the Word and worship God. I'm engaging in the spiritual warfare, and I will conquer all the enemies. I will be a watchman and preach the gospel and warn those that will not turn to the Lord. I will also deal with myself, all sin, and I will conquer it. I will judge myself so I will not be judged. I will put on righteousness. I will be holy. I will come out of all bondage into the liberty of Jesus Christ. I will be healed and delivered. I will cast out every spirit. I will walk in your ways, take hold of the promises. I will go on to perfection. I will be sanctified, spirit, soul, and body, to be preserved blameless under the coming of the Lord. I will receive the true doctrine, the teaching of righteousness, the rain coming forth, bringing great fruitfulness in my life for the great harvest that is coming forth. I will be obedient. I will have the fear of God. I will work out my salvation. I will get strong in the Lord. I will do what God says. I will not have any fear of what's going on in the earth. My eyes are on the Lord. I'm going to be a part of that end time church, the remnant who are going to be filled with the glory of God and carry out the work of the Lord. The river of God is coming into me. I'm going to get filled. Ankles, knees, loins, overflowing me. The living waters are coming into me, and I will be a vessel to God flow through to bring forth the great harvest of souls and bring healing and deliverance. I will be a part of the glorious church in these last days. I thank you, Lord, for all that you are doing and all that you'll continue to do in my life. I make you Lord of all. I'm not about to walk in sin or in the flesh or in the ways of this world. I am following the Lord. I will put him first place, and I will walk in line with his word, obedient in all things, hearkening to his voice, working out my own salvation, having the fear of God before me. I thank you, Lord, for the river that's coming in me. Thank you for the fulfillment of that great work in the body of Christ. And I thank you, Jesus, you are going to fulfill these on the exact day. Thank you that I'll be a part of the catching up of the church to meet the Lord in the air. And I will be then coming back with you to reign and rule with you as a priest before God for 1,000 years. And then be with the Father throughout eternity. Thank you, Lord. I'm not about to give place to the devil. Jesus is Lord of all in my life. I'm walking the straight and narrow. And I will not turn to the right or to the left. I'm one of the few, one of the remnant. I've made my decision. This night, I'm walking the right way from this day forward. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. It's going to be wonderful. It's only going to happen if you do what he says. It won't happen if you don't do what he says. You do have an adversary, the devil, who's going to try you every which way. No, we're going to walk the walk, and we're going to see God accomplish what he wants. You know, the first step is being born again. You've got to be born again. We know that we need to confess our sins, repent, and turn from it, and put him first place. I want to lead you in a prayer. Say this with me. Say, Heavenly Father, I declare that Jesus Christ is my Lord. I confess all sins that I have committed, and I believe I receive forgiveness and cleansing from all unrighteousness. I do repent and change my mind and turn away from all that's not of you. I put the Word of God first place in my life. Thank you for teaching me all of your ways and bringing forth fruitfulness. I will walk in your ways and do your mighty works. Thank you for this great work accomplished in me. I truly make you Lord of all, because I'm a hearer and a doer of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. If this message doesn't stir you up, there's something wrong. If this doesn't want to get you on the right path, there's something wrong. Walk the walk. God's going to do it. It's going to happen. And it's going to be glorious. Praise God. If you need prayer, I want to invite you to come forward. Glad to pray for you, minister any areas. God bless. Have a great week.